Given the extraordinary and colorful lives of each of the composers on this program, I could devote this entire time to discussing biographies and really only begin to scratch the surface. But since my role here is to prepare us for an orchestral performance, that is, an in-the-moment audio and visual experience, I'm going to focus on the music itself and the sounds we're going to have on the program. But to learn much more about each of the works, composers, context of composition, etc., I encourage everyone to explore Richard Rota's notes in the digital program book. Now, one of the things about this program is that you're probably going to encounter some unfamiliar work. In fact, three of the five works on the program are being performed by the Des Moines Symphony Orchestra for the first time. And the other two have only been performed once previously by the orchestra, one of them in 1982, and the other in 1960. And this should be an exciting opportunity. It's like visiting an art gallery where we know where a few of the famous and well-loved works are, but as we move between them, we encounter so many other exciting gems that remind us that there is so much more to the experience beyond a few greatest hits. And we can even look at this as a silver lining to our current circumstances. As orchestras work to find music that works for the smaller number of musicians, more limited space and venues, it means that we're going to be introducing audiences to music that they don't know as well, but that could very well pave the way for these works to become favorite hits of the future. American composer William Bolcom is a true chameleon of a composer who is equally at home with crunchy, adventurous, modernist sounds as he is with popular music and ragtime. He's often at his best when these seemingly disparate worlds collide and are brought together and the sacred profane are met in equal measures. Commedia is a superb example of this combination of styles. The title is drawn from the 16th century Italian tradition Commedia dell'arte, and the subtitle for almost 18th century orchestra refers to the fact that the instrumentation is similar to that of a late Haydn symphony with the very notable addition of a piano part. And he chooses this instrumentation because the work was first performed by the St. Paul Chamber Orchestra in 1972. The music is rich with comedy and zany gesture. It's like cartoon music. It draws its inspiration from the Commedia dell'arte, which uses stock scenarios and stock characters as a framework for improvisation and physical comedy. Because masks are an essential component of the Commedia dell'arte, the performers must use their entire bodies to draw out the comedy in a very physical manner, and gesture is the basis for much of the humor. Likewise, Bolcom's music is rooted in gesture and comedic timing. It's a disjunct pastiche that uses quotation and quasi-quotation to great effect. Take, for example, the very opening. We hear a reference to Papageno's aria, the birdcatcher aria from Mozart's Magic Flute, with this rising scale. And then it's immediately followed by a very tense woodwind chord, which for those familiar with Beethoven's First Symphony might be reminiscent of the very opening bars of that work.
Drum kann ich froh und lustig sein, denn alle Vögel sind ja mein.
Bolcom then sticks these ideas together in conversation and adds in bizarre elements like magnificent swells in the horns and timpani that seem almost like a fever dream. The results are delightful. And as it continues, we encounter music that is reminiscent of Rossini, and there's some Tarantella styles, bits and pieces of quotation. It's something that you'll probably recognize if you've paid attention to the music in classic cartoons. In 1779, John Adams was on a diplomatic trip to Paris in the company of French naval captain Pierre Landais. And in his diary, Adams describes how Landais told him about Saint-Georges, a mixed-race man in Paris who was, quote, the most accomplished man in Europe in riding, running, shooting, fencing, dancing, music. He will hit the button, any button, on the coat or waistcoat of the greatest masters. He will hit a crown piece in the air with a pistol ball. Landais was describing Joseph Bologne, Chevalier de Saint-Georges, and the passing reference to his skill in music seems to be quite an understatement considering his exceptional accomplishments as a violinist, a conductor, and as a composer. He was concertmaster and leader of one of the greatest orchestras in Europe at the time, and he was a personal favorite of Marie Antoinette, with whom he played duets. As the child of a white plantation owner and an African slave, Bologne was barred from holding titles, but his exceptional skill with a sword led Louis XV to ignore the code and give him the title of Chevalier de Saint-Georges. With such a remarkable biography, it's easy to marvel at the man and overlook the music, but doing so would be a mistake. In the case of Bologne's Symphony No. 2, we have an example of an early classical era symphony that celebrates the values of the style of that era, but it also demonstrates some really appealing creative approaches. A desire for musical and emotional balance was a prevailing value in the classical era. That is, balance between such things as fast and slow, major and minor, stability and struggle, lyrical and gestural, etc. And this symphony is traditional in many ways, including its instrumentation with two oboes, two horns, and strings, a very common combination for Haydn's symphonies at the same time and early Mozart symphonies, and the setup where there are three movements, a fast, a slow, and another fast movement, is very common for the early classical era symphony. The key of D major is popular, it works well, it's very resonant with the string instruments, and it also pitches the horns in the most common key for hunting horns at that time. And that works particularly well in the last chasse-like movement that is like a hunting scene at times. Listeners familiar with the classical style may also notice Bologne's very dramatic approach to the development or middle section of the first movement, where it's more of an operatic or theatrical style. And this is very fitting when we consider that he also repurposed this symphony and used it as an overture for one of his operas. With a program titled Past and Present, it sure makes sense to include some music that's been composed in the last 10 years. And Jesse Montgomery's Banner is a perfect fit. Beginning her career as an accomplished violinist, Montgomery has evolved into an important voice in the worlds of composition and music education alike. Her association with the Sphinx Organization, a Detroit-based group established to address underrepresentation of people of color in classical music, has played an important role in that development. She now serves as composer in residence for the Sphinx Virtuosi, the premier professional Sphinx ensemble. Benner was commissioned as a tribute to the 200th anniversary of Francis Scott Key's poem, The Star-Spangled Banner, in 2014. Of course, it's worth noting that the tune we associate with The Star-Spangled Banner was actually composed in England in the 1770s as a drinking song for a men's club. And it was not until 1931 that it became the official national anthem of the United States, beating out some very stiff competition from America, or My Country Tis of Thee, and America the Beautiful. So why would such a history be important for understanding Jesse Montgomery's banner? Well, sometimes people hear of an abstraction or a re-envisioning of a national anthem, and their hackles are raised. They think of it as disrespectful or inappropriate. But we also have to keep in mind that in most cases, these anthems have existed well before they were associated with the text that turned them into a national anthem. They existed as music first. But also, for a composer, it's a form of appreciation and engagement with that music, and there is some wonderful precedent for this. One fantastic example is Charles Ives' Variations on America, a bold and sometimes jarring treatment of a song that at the time was used more commonly as the American national anthem than the Star-Spangled Banner. And despite the raucous approach, there's no questioning Ives' love for patriotic songs, even if this one happens to be also the national anthem of the United Kingdom. Montgomery's banner channels a similar spirit as it explores the essence of the original tune through a variety of cultural lenses, reflecting the optimism as well as the struggles and contradictions of the nation it symbolizes. Haydn's 83rd Symphony fits into this program with particular finesse. It's a wonderful example of a work from the past that remains fresh and lively today, and it features the characteristic wit that we associate with Haydn and whose spirit inhabits composers today, especially things like William Bolcom's Commedia. And the origins of the symphony tie directly into another composer on this program. When Haydn was first approached with the commission for the so-called Paris symphonies, including this 83rd symphony, it was none other than Joseph Bologna, the Chevalier de Saint-Georges, who handled the negotiations and in fact conducted the premieres. Of at least 106 symphonies by Haydn, this is one of only 11 that's in a minor key. And it's only this first movement that actually uses the minor key. Haydn uses this dramatic struggle between major and minor to magnificent effect. Adding to that drama are his clever use of pauses and a recurrent jagged rhythmic motive that appears in a variety of guises. The first movement begins with a rising gesture that is fraught with harmonic tension. And it's followed by this jagged rhythm that leads directly to a sudden silence. Then the pattern repeats, setting up our expectation, but then leaving it unfulfilled as the silence doesn't return where we expect it for quite some time, and the jagged rhythm takes over and eventually becomes the subject of argument between the strings and the winds. Then in classic Haydn-esque style, these two main ideas continue to grapple with one another until they escape the minor key and break forth into sunlight. As with other nicknamed Haydn symphonies, this one received its sobriquet La Poule, or the Hen, several years after its composition when someone decided that the second theme in the violins sounded like the clucking of a hen. And with a particularly clever bit of fun, Haydn brings back, in the solo oboe, that jagged rhythm from before in a manner that could resemble a chicken scratching. Like many composers, Edward MacDowell, as a matter of discipline or compositional exercise, had a regular habit of composing a little bit each morning. It's a way of stretching the creative muscle, so to speak, and composing when the stakes are low. It doesn't necessarily have to be good, it's just putting some notes on the page to see what happens. Usually MacDowell would just dispose of these little fragments, but one morning he crumpled one up and tossed it toward the fireplace and he missed. And later his wife, curious, opened it up, took a look at it, and discovered what she described as a charming little melody, and she encouraged him to take another look at it. And we're lucky that that survived the flames that morning, because it became the basis for the first of his 10 woodland sketches, To a Wild Rose. It remains one of his most beloved compositions, and it's an example of exquisite melodic writing. So what makes this miniature character piece so appealing? It's remarkably simple, yet has some wonderful harmonic surprises, and the melody is comprised of a delightful conversation between rising gestures and gently falling responses that work together to develop a compelling narrative. The result is charming and somewhat magical. And now I invite you to join the Des Moines Symphony Orchestra and Maestro Joseph Giunta for Past and Present.